This is the Courier Talking Football. I'm Eric Nicolson, and with me this week, we're going to say, is Jim Spence. Unfortunately, poor Sean is a late dropout. He's been suffering, goes for a week's holiday, and comes back with no voice.
Tight larynx.
Tight larynx.
Feel a late larynx test.
I know. It's losing his voice, not something you've ever been troubled with, Jim, is it?
Well, I mean, it's almost happened on a couple of occasions, Eric, but I've always managed to just kind of hang in there, you know. I've kind of sounded husky on a few occasions, but it's never actually happened to me on air. But poor Sean was sitting there raring to go, but, you know, like a true professional, he turned up, but it was just, it was always going to go, wasn't it?
He was like a player getting hooked after half an hour in the first half, trudging out the studio there. Eh? But then I went, listen, you've never lacked anything to say, Jim, and I'll do my best to join you with this.
Whether I say anything sensible, Eric, that's another thing.
Just think of all the things you can say now, but just the two of us.
Just the two of us.
Well, I mean, there's lots to talk about as well. I was just thinking on Saturday night, as far as the Dundee teams are concerned, not often you get two sort of, well, obviously United played on the Friday, but the highs that both clubs have had on the same weekend. You've got United effectively winning the league, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
We can say that. We can now speak with a bit of certainty, and Dundee claiming top six, whether you think top six is over-egged and all the rest of it. It is a legitimate goal that a lot of teams have in the league, and they've got it, and they got it in a wee bit of a dramatic style as well. You know, the Hibs Motherwell thing happening as Dundee were drawn with Aberdeen. But so anyway, we've not started with United for a wee while, have we?
Yep.
So I think we can say United have won the league, and they deserve all the credit that goes with it, with the way that they've rallied, sorted themselves out, and got the job done.
Yeah, I mean, mathematically, I suppose, if they absolutely collapsed and Wraith went into their next three games.
What's the goal difference again? Are we less than 40 these days?
They're on 46 to Wraith's 10, so looking at 36. So, you know, unless Wraith go into their next three games winning by a margin of something like 50-0, United collapse, the league is won, you know, and promotion is secured. I mean, they can mathematically make it absolutely certain on Friday night, because Wraith are up at Inverness, and if Wraith, drop 2 points, I think that...
Which I think they probably will, actually.
Yeah, that wouldn't surprise me at all, because Inverness are still very much battling to avoid that second bottom spot. They're only a couple of points ahead of Queen's Park, you know. So Big Duncan and Gary Boland, you often forget Gary's up there with him as his sidekick, you know. A lot of good people up there, actually. Scotty Kelly, I don't know if you ever dealt with Scotty Kelly.
No, I didn't.
Wasn't well for a long time. He's one of the coaches. You'll see him taking the guys before the games and that, you know. He's a good guy. So, you know, I'd be very pleased to see Inverness kind of escaping that as well, because we know the guys up there. But, you know, from our perspective, it's all about, in this instance, it's about United. Wraith, I hope, can do it in the playoffs.
I think United fans will hope they do it on Friday night as well, won't they? Because you kind of want to celebrate on your own pitch.
I think so. Well, I mean, you know, the United can celebrate and tie it up at home against Partick. You know, not tie it up, but they can have the big party against Partick on the last day of the season, you know. But I think there's no doubt that they have secured the league, and you know, the 4-1 win at Morton, which was kind of a really, really good win. I mean,
as comprehensive as it comes.
They've hit this kind of this wee vein of form now, and they've kind of, to be honest with you, they've shown the kind of the killer touch and the sure-footedness that was missing for a wee spell, you know. I mean, they'll have won the league pretty well. I don't think anybody expected a major chance from Wraith or anybody else.
Partick would have probably been.
That's right.
And Queen's Park, it sounds ridiculous now when you see where they are, but at the start of the season, they were a bit of an unknown quantity because the whole Dutch influence, they came close the year before, they were still spending. I think even early in the season, I remember speaking to Rab Douglas for his column in the paper. And he was quite impressed with them when he saw them play Arbroath and thought they would be, if anything, they were a better team than they had been this year before. So, you know, we kind of thought they would as well. Maybe, I didn't think Ayr would. I never thought.
I thought Dunfermline might.
Thought Dunfermline might be better than they were, but
yeah,
We did expect United to win it handily, didn't we?
Yeah, and they now look as though they're going to do that. You know, maybe not by as big a margin as. Although in saying that, there's three games to go. You know, there's three games to go. They could end up taking full points from all of them. Wraith could end up struggling, and it could look very handsome indeed. But the thing is, from a United perspective, you know, from everybody employed at Tannadice, it really doesn't matter whether you win it massively handsomely or whether you squeeze over the line. Better to win it handsomely, but it's getting over the line that counts, and be back in the Premiership, because that's where they've got to be. I mean, I'm sure you're going to touch on, you know, various finances and football at some stage in this podcast, but United, you know, United's kind of finances are not great, and they can't be when you're in the Championship. There's just no money to be made. There is no money to be made. There's very little to be made in the Premiership, you know. But you need to be back. You need to be back in the Premiership for all sorts of things. Without any, you know, disrespect to, you know, the teams down there. I mean, games against Airdrie and Inverness and Queen's Park don't really titillate the fans. It's astonishing the crowds that United have had this season. Yes. You want to be in the Premiership. You want to, you know, it's not even Celtic and Rangers. You want to be playing the Dundee Derby. You want to be playing against Sage. You want to be playing Hibs, Hearts and Aberdeen. You want those games with the big crowds and really testing yourself, you know. So it's great that they're back up. I mean, as I say, it would take a mathematical miracle of biblical proportions, you know. Not so sure if there were any mathematical miracles in the Bible, you know, but I mean,
or if there were any football reports. You know?
So I think Jim Goodwin and the boys have done the job.
Jim Goodwin, I mean, the Jim Goodwin story, it's a podcast in itself, isn't it? And I think it's fascinating for what happens next. I give him a lot of credit for the post-Dunfermline. I had serious doubts about whether they had what it takes to get it over the line after that. Watching that performance at East End Park, I thought they were a bit of a mess, weren't they? You know, defensively and in terms of, I didn't see a great sort of tactical plan. It looked like an attacking formation, but didn't play like an attacking formation. So, you know, and pieces of the team that you thought, well, that they had built their season on, you know, i.e. the centre halves were suddenly looking really, really shaky. I think the only bit I will say where he got lucky, and it sounds ridiculous to say this because of the maybe it's maybe harsh to say in Kevin Holt's terms, but I think the fact that he has almost been forced to go with Declan Gallagher and Sam McClelland has helped him. And
with Ross Graham and McClelland.
Sorry, Ross Graham. Who did I say?
Declan Gallagher.
Ross Graham and
the injury
Sam McClelland has helped them. And I don't think we would have seen that partnership if Holt and Gallagher had stayed fit. I think it's that simple. And I think that those two, now you could discuss whether you think either or both are Premiership players yet. But they have been absolutely outstanding, haven't they, in these last three games, I think it is.
They've grabbed their opportunity. I think that's the key thing. I mean, I like Graham. I mean, I said earlier in the season, but it was always going to be difficult for him to break through against an experienced centre half duo.
The manager had signed as well.
Holt and Gallagher had made the position theirs, and they'd played well. They had a couple of wee kind of sticky moments, but I mean, by and large, you know, they'd played well. So, you know, as one man's injury is another man's good fortune. In football, and so it's proven with McClelland was about 6th choice centre half at McDermid, you know, was nowhere to be seen, and Graham I think was banging the manager's
door. Not through his own fault, I have to say, but circumstances. He was injured, the manager
of football.
Craig Levine hadn't seen him and it was perfectly sensible that he got loaned out. And listen, it's not as if we're going into Saints territory here for a wee bit, but up until about 4 weeks ago or whatever it was, it was looking distinctly possible that Sam McClelland, that was looking like a daft loan, because Sam McClelland wasn't getting a game, and
that's
he was fourth choice centre half at United. So, you know, that's exactly where we're at. But carry on, sorry, Jim.
But I mean, the same young Ross Graham. I'm going to address that minute.
Young
Ross Graham,
middle-aged Ross Graham.
Yeah, I mean, he's not a veteran, but he's not a boy anymore, you know. But the same with him. I mean, he must have been incredibly frustrated because he's playing in training. When he has got a game, he's done very, very well.
And he's done well.
But he's got two experienced central defenders there who are kind of fixture in the manager's mind, because managers are like that, you know. They've got two experienced guys here who haven't let them down. They're thinking, you know, he, you know, Graham's thinking, what have I got to do to get, unless he's going to change the system and play three central defenders, what do I have to do to get in this team? And actually that you know, one issue in football always leads to another, and I think this current issue leads to a potential problem for next season for United. I don't want to get ahead of myself here.
I think if we're giving them the title, you get ahead of yourself, Jim.
Well, he's played, you know, Graham has played well. Him and McClellan look like a very useful central half pairing. That said, it's a Championship, you've got to bear that in mind. You step up the Premiership, you're up against forwards who are quicker on the turn, spin off your shoulder quicker, take it in better, or maybe physically stronger, physically quicker. All of these things are better at link-up play. So, you know, you're measuring them at a level at the moment. It's whether the team can step up. But McClellan goes back to his parent club, you know, and Graham, I don't think there's any way that Graham is going to be happy.
Well, he's out of contract.
Yeah, that's right. It's not going to be any way he's going to be happy at the prospect of playing second fiddle next season. So United are now going to have to satisfy him. Otherwise, he'll be thinking, right, okay, what's the story here, Gaffer? You know, am I going to be first choice? No manager can actually say, yes, you're definitely going to be first choice, but you'll need to give him more than a nod and a wink, I thought.
I said to you in this podcast, I can't remember when did Jim Goodwin make the decision when they were both fit and Graham was in the team and he brought Gallagher back in? Whatever the game was, say it was a couple of months ago, wasn't it? And I remember saying to you at that point, it's a huge test of Jim Goodwin for the here now in terms of managing for the rest of the season, which he has done. But one other thing I said was, in no way, Ross Graham will not forget this. For forever now, he will know in the back of his mind, whatever sweet talking Jim Goodwin does in the summer, he will now know he doesn't rate me as much as I rate myself. I think that's a fair point to make, isn't it?
Because, or he doesn't rate me as much as Holt or Gallagher.
Yeah.
You know, so at that stage, at that point,
ultimately, he's going to think, that will never go. As long as Jim Goodwin is the manager at Dundee United and Ross Graham is the player, he will have something in the back of his mind thinking, does he absolutely rate me as much as, say, a manager that would want to go out and sign me and say, look, I've been looking at you. Hi, of course you are. You're my man. That's going to niggle him, isn't it?
Well, every manager has his favourites. And I don't mean that in terms of kind of, I'm playing this boy because I like him.
I'm not blaming Jim Goodwin. He has to make the choice.
I'm talking about personality favourites. I'm talking about, you know, every manager looks at individual players and thinks, that's my chosen, you know, everything else being equal, that's my central defensive pairing, or that's my right back, or that's my left-sided midfielder, everything else being equal. Now, the key thing is, you know, for an open-minded manager, he'll watch others in training, and he'll watch others when they get their first team chance and think, actually, you know, this guy's moved up the pecking order more than I thought he might, or I'm glad to see that he has, et cetera, et cetera, and he might well be prepared to change his mind. What you will find out, if the squad, as is at the moment, is there next season, you'll find out then whether Jim Goodwin thinks that Graham has done enough to solidify, that's assuming that he signs a new contract and all the rest of it, to solidify his position in the team. Now, where is he going to do it? Because, you know, Gallagher, he's younger than both the injured central defensive pairing, but neither the two of them are kind of in the veteran stages, you know. So they would look, they'd be the pairing, Holt and Gallagher, you would expect to play in the Premiership.
Is that a Premiership centre half pairing?
You'll find out. You'll find out in the first six or eight games whether they
are. Do you think we will? I think whether it's Jim Goodwin or whoever, I think there'll be another centre half.
I don't know. I don't think it's.
I don't think that'll be their centre half.
Well,
pairing.
I don't think it's a Premiership squad.
Yeah. I mean, not by a long distance.
I watched this argument the other night. I mean, I saw a guy who kind of follows me on X, and he said, "Oh, you know, that team will compete no problem in the Premiership." I think he's well wide of the mark with that. I mean, there's substantial strengthening needing done. I mean, I like the idea of bigger league and all the rest of it. And people will say to me, "There's no quality," and I'm saying, "I'm not arguing that there's a quality. What I'm arguing is after 3 or 4 years, you might then get the quality when you know." Wraiths and Partick's or Mortons in 3 or 4 years
clubs,
are getting more money coming in, strengthening their youth squad and all the rest. I'm not arguing for a moment that there's enough at the moment. So what I'm kind of trying to say in all of that is that there is a gap. There is a gap between even the top of the Championship and even the lower reaches mm-hmm. of the Premiership, because guys are playing at a higher level every week. It's like running. You know, you can go and run and do decent times and all the rest of it. Then you go with fellow runners and you mm-hmm. run with them, and the next thing you're beating at your jacksie, mm-hmm. you know, bluntly, because you're running at a higher a tempo, you're running with guys that are better than you, that push you and all the rest. And it's the same in football. There are levels all the time. And United next season will be stepping up to a level which is a fair bit higher. I look at the United squad at the minute, and I look at that Dundee squad, and I think that Dundee squad would blow United away, because they're playing at a higher tempo every single week. They're playing at a higher competition every single week. You know, so you know, not only the central defensive pairing, the entire squad, I think, will have to be reshaped and rebuilt, and there'll be more than a few. I'd have thought that. You know, come the last game against Partick Thistle, there'll be more than a few that you'll not be seeing again in Tangerine.
That's the thing. I mean, I had absolutely no problem with the strategy of getting a team built to get yourself out the league that you're in. I think it's been. I go back to, do you remember the Kenny Dalglish's Blackburn team? Yeah. He had Jack Walker's mm-hmm. millions, but he didn't make the big Shearer Sutton mm-hmm. signings to get them out the. Whatever it was called mm-hmm. at that point, the second tier in England. He used guys like I think David Speedy. It was a team built to get out mm-hmm. the second division. Mm-hmm. Got out, and then it was just like no sentiment. We need different players. Of course, Dundee United. We will find out. Will they get new money in? If it's as it is. I don't think United will be able to do a Dundee, for example. Now, you can argue whether Dundee had the finances mm-hmm. to do a Dundee and whether, you know, that's got them in trouble, but that's a different debate. Dundee were able to rebuild a side at a higher standard than I thought they would be able to, mm-hmm. but they did, because they found the money and they did it. Dundee United will need to rebuild their team again. It's just to what standard. And I see, I've not seen Dundee United in the flesh all season, mm-hmm. so I've only seen them on the TV, but I would go through that team, and I think there's doubts over more players than there aren't, I would suggest, in terms of are they Premiership ready. Now, mm-hmm. there's a few of them that will be good, very good squad players, or will look better when they've got better players around them. But there aren't many, I don't think, you can maybe correct me if I'm wrong, there aren't many who you would go through and say, yeah, definitely good enough right here, right now, for a Dundee United to be sort of, not just stay up, but be looking to do a Dundee or just below it, you know, to be safe, not to be having in a relegation. But I mean, how many of them, do you think are Premiership absolute... Well, copper-bottomed guaranteed.
Well, the thing is, you're not looking at a team. You're looking at a squad, because mm-hmm. it's a squad game. So, you know, you're looking at, do I have a squad of 18 to 20 players who are Premiership material? I don't think they have. And the best way to do that is to look at the bench that they had out against Morton mm-hmm. in the 4-1 game. I mean, you go through it. You know, Wotherspoon. Now, you know, we're both Spoonie fans. He's.
I doubt he'll be in the back end of United next season.
That's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking, is he going to get another deal to play in the Premiership at Tannadice? I don't know. But he wasn't at Saints. You go to Tilson, Miller Thompson. I like. He's
obviously,
a young boy bringing through.
Tilson is a no.
Meekison, Mulcrae, McLeod. You know, Cujo. I like Cujo, but I don't know whether Jim Goodwin rates him highly enough to think that he's got.
So they're all.
Plus
they're
he's
all,
out of contract as well.
They would all be squad players at best. The starting lineup.
So. In terms of the start lineup, I like the goalkeeper.
Yes,
Walton. I like him. You know, Grimshaw I actually quite like as a right back, but I mean, I don't know if he's going to kind of set the Premiership. McMahon. I actually like McMahon as well, but I like him. I probably like him better than Grimshaw. Decent player. The two central defenders, Gallagher and Hall, will be tested much more than they've been tested this season. You know, you're in quicker players, sharper players, more physically strong players, and all the rest of it. The midfield, Docherty and Sybil's had a great season. Docherty, I think, has been worth his weight in gold.
But, Doherty, yes. Doherty for me might be one of these that's a very good Championship player.
Yeah, I think Doherty can play at that level in the Premiership.
Well, I'd be intrigued. He's one that intrigues me. I think he certainly deserves a chance.
Yeah. What's got the talent in the world, but at the Premiership level, I think he'd be submerged. You know, I mean, there are players, you know, there are defences and midfielders that will take care of kind of what he's offering, I think, easily enough. Middleton, I don't think, will trouble people in the Premiership. Fotheringham, I like, but needs support, needs good players round about him. And Moult up front.
He's on the right trajectory, yeah, Fotheringham.
Moult will get you goals, there's no doubt about that, but he needs service.
But again, I've got a wee doubt with him because he's been that. Mm-hmm. We're talking a while since he's scored goals at the top flight.
At that level, that's right. So he needs service, and it is a wee while. And then you ask, is he as sharp as he would need to be? A couple of years on from when he was at his best at Motherwell, is he as sharp as he will need to be to play against, you know, top defences? We're not talking about just Celtic and Rangers. I mean, they're the lost leaders. You expect nothing against them, you know, although Ross County kind of disproved that at the weekend. you expect nothing there, but against that, you know, a Hearts, against it, what you would think would be a renewed Aberdeen, a renewed Hibs, and then the St Mirren's and the Kilmarnocks.
I mean, Kilmarnock are a very good team. St Mirren are a very good team. Dundee are a very good team.
Yeah, Dundee are, that's right. You know, so, I mean, you're stepping up a level, and you're stepping up a substantial level. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you're not stepping up the English Premiership, you're stepping up a substantial level. So I think, you know, United will have to add, I think, substantially. You're talking about maybe, what, 8 or 9 players.
I think you could be at double. More. I think they could be at double figures. Yeah, well,
very, very easily. You know, so certainly 8s and 9s and all the rest of it. So and the thing is, I often think that Tony Docherty has kind of put a big X on a lot of managers' doors because, you know, people go, it takes time to build, and you mould a team, you gel a team. Docherty comes in and he goes, okay, we'll have him, boom, top six. He's put together. Now it's a bit more complex than that. He will undoubtedly have good recruitment people around him. I wonder what role Strachan's played. But he's the manager. Tony Doherty's the manager who's done a tremendous job. You know, he's built that Dundee side who have also played good football. You know, I mean, they've had their moments. They've conceded daft goals and all the rest of it, but they've played good football. They've been good to watch. They've been entertaining. They've been physically strong. They've been quick. You know, and they've got a top six spot. Now, my views on the top six are well known. It's a manufactured piece of excitement.
But it's been with us long enough to mean something now.
We are where we are. It's what we've got, and to get there against the likes of Aberdeen and Hibs with much bigger budgets, I think he's done a really, really good job. And if you were to come, you know, and here's another thing, you know, come now, never mind next season. I mean, you know, recruitment has already started. It's probably started a while back. You know, when you've got agents and managers looking at players, everyone's looking at them. United will be looking at some of the players that Dundee will be looking at, you know. Now, it's bad enough that the likes of Sky hardly know the difference between Dundee and Dundee United. Agents and players down south and elsewhere might not know either.
Which I think you'll get so the sign before. I've got the wrong ground.
Who are you going to go to? You know, you're going to go to the team that have just popped up from the Championship, or are you going to go to the team that were in top six have a sniff at Europe?
There was somebody a few years ago, wasn't there, that thought he was signing for the other one? I can't remember who it was.
that's not the first time, I think. That's hard, you know. I mean, from United's perspective, we touched on this other week as well about Jim Goodwin. I mean, you know, much depends on. I mean, Jim will be tested again next season in the Premiership, and it's a harder test than it is in the Championship. So, I kind of wonder if other people might be looking at him and thinking, you know, is he? And I'm thinking, south of the border.
You dropped that one in the end of the last podcast, and time was marching on, so I didn't really have to, and we'd had so many bigger issues.
Football's a career.
Is that just something that you just you think, hold on a minute here, that, you know, let's not all look at this from just one side, because let's face it, you know, whether it was, I know that you said it wasn't quite what happened in the ground wasn't the same as what I was picking up on social media after United were losing games or being pretty a grim watch even when they were winning them. I was seeing a fan base that was like not having Jim Goodwin.
There's a lot of them don't fancy it, so
you kind of come at it from that perspective. But you quite rightly pointed out Jim Goodwin may have drained him over the course of the year, and he will be asking questions of the ownership of, you know,
Well, they want to know what his budget is going to be.
He want to know what his budget. If he thinks if he's got to do a squad rebuild on a bottom three of the league budget, he's in more danger of doing his. He can't afford an. I would suggest he can't afford another Premiership flop on the back of what happened at Aberdeen to really to keep him at a level he probably thinks he should be in terms of the the jobs he should be after, can he? So he has to be sensible as well. As from my point of view, I can see I think the money will come in for United this this summer because I think they'll get their I think they'll get their partner. Don't think it'll be a full takeover. I think they'll get their partner.
Liverpool, you were suggesting?
I don't know. I was not suggesting that at all. I was merely picking up on a piece of research that was out there, Rish, but. I don't know. I want Liverpool by Saints, but no. But so I think there will be. I think, and I think that obviously changes. And I do think that Jim Goodwin has done enough with the manner in which I was 50-50. Yeah. Like I said, go back to that Dunfermline game. I think the manner in which he's going through the tape, bursting the tape rather than stumbling over the line. I don't think this is the same as Gary Bowyer. I don't think it's the same scenario.
Oh, no, I mean,
if there'll be money, I think it would be incredibly harsh not to give him the chance to spend it and go again. Is he going to be able to do it in the Premiership? Will these sort of grumbles? Very rare that these grumbles go away. So, if United got off to a slow, I mean, we're not only going to the summer, we're going to the next season, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's a lot of them are now not convinced about Jim Goodwin.
I'm not of a mind that United are going to punt Jim Goodwin. If I'm of a mind of anything, I'm not saying I am, but I've been about football long enough to know kind of roughly how it works. I mean, I'm of a mind to think that there's going to be any movement. It might be that Jim thinks, well, now would be a good time. You know, my stock is quite high. I've just won this team promotion. I've got my career back on track after the blip at Aberdeen. And remember, Eric, you can go to the third tier in English football as a manager and make the kind of money you can make as a Dundee United boss. And then the world's not your oyster, but there are so many more avenues and opportunities.
Derek Adams is making a living down south of the border.
Absolutely, has done for a while, you know. That's nothing other than speculation. But I mean, you know, if you're a manager, you want to know. What you're going to have to work with now. Or you want a rough idea what you're going to have to work with. You also want to kind of know roughly what the structures are. I mean, you know, if there is to be a partner coming, whether it's a Brighton with Tony Bloom or you hear all sorts of things about Bloom that if he's interested, he's only interested in the football side and things like that. You know, I don't quite know how that would work. You know, you come in but you take over the football side. I know he's looking at other Scottish clubs anyway. So, you know, others have been kind of interested as well, haven't they? Brentford and you know, I mean. Until such times as any deal is done and dusted, it's all speculation. But in terms of Jim, he's done what he's been asked to do. He's got United up, you know. I mean, a lot of people are critical and saying, well, when he came in, you know, he only had five games and he didn't. We went down under him. But, I mean, United were a bust flush, I think, when he came in anyhow. You know, they were always, I think, heading to the Championship.
He didn't help
But he's got them up, and that's what he was brought in to do.
I give him a solid 7.5 out of 10.
Yeah. I mean, you cannot be critical of.
Maybe even an 8. It's sunshine, isn't it?
It's no that I came down in the vest with it. It's bloody freezing. But don't let it fool you. And it's the same in football. Don't let it fool you either. You know, I mean, they've come up. I mean, you know, who knows if there's a partner club come in, depending on who it is. You know, it depends how it affects Mark Ogden. It depends what that partner club want. Depends how big a stake they take. I don't know whether it'll. You know, I think you're maybe more confident than me that it'll happen for next season. It may well, and it seems to be the way of the world at the minute. I mean, Motherwell are in talks with an American-owned club. Hearts are in talk. You know,
time's marching on already. You know, if next season does feel like a long time away, but budgets are being made, targets are being lined up. So it's. You're right. They're almost against the clock already. So we'll just. I think the first couple of weeks at the end of the season are crucial. If we're not hearing anything for United, then you're starting to think will this happen in time for it to mean something in terms of the budget for next season.
The fan thing is interesting. I mean, I suspect if you take the two City clubs, they'll be playing in the derbies next season, which is great. But you know, if you took, I mean, I kind of think a one Dundee fan, if you went to them and say, right, you know. should we, you know, mm-hmm. next season we're in six, should we push on, should we get rid of Tony Docherty and bring somebody else in? They go like, are you mad? You know, you're crazy. You know, I kind of think at one Dundee fan of my acquaintance that would say, they would think you were a lunatic.
We could do better.
But there's
yeah.
a lot of United fans, if you say, look, you know, should we get rid of Jim Goodwin and go, well, that's, yeah. you know, why. That wouldn't trouble a lot of them, you know. That's just the nature of the beast.
It's a good way of phrasing it, isn't it?
That's the nature of the beast. I mean, you know, I'm sure if you went and said, you know, should we dump Jim Spence as a columnist, you'd maybe find one or two that would say.
Think so?
You know, I mean, it's the nature of football. It's just the nature of football, you know. But I tell you what, I've got to touch on, you know. I remember McCall Miller was talking about Graham, because I like the lad, he's a central defender. But I'd mentioned kind of some of the about youth, and then I'm sitting watching Barcelona last week, and Lamal pops up, and who's the other guy? Yeah, was it the midfielder? 16 or 17 years of age.
I know, and at certain positions you're trained not to expect a 16-year-old centre-half, aren't you?
16 and 17-year-old playing against mm-hmm. PSG, two of the top sides in the world, and there's that kind of bravery. And I think sometimes we're just still too, you know, there's a bit of the old windbaggery in Scottish football. Oh, he's too young. And then you look and you think, wow, Jerome's Graham's 23 now. McClellan 22.
22, yes.
You know, these are no boys anymore. They're young men. You know, they're young men. I'd quite like to see that partnership at Tannadice next season. I think they do what it says in the tin. I said that they just defend. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm kind of... I've got a real bee in my bonnet about kind of defenders wanting to play.
Oh, yeah, yeah, back, yeah, yeah.
I mean, see, when I watched that stuff last night with Everton and the goalkeeper trying to play.
What a team they are. What a rabble they are. I'm the same as you. I know it's, you just do what you do and then give it to somebody that's in the team.
I mean, if you're Franco Baresi, yeah, you can do it all night. But, you know, he's about 49 now, right enough, you know. But, no, I mean, it's just, you know. I just don't like it. But those two do what it says in the tin. But I doubt very much if they'll be the central defensive pair, because McClellan will be going back to Saints, and Graham, who knows what will happen with Graham. You know, you'd like to think that he would want to stay. I mean, in Scottish terms, United are still one of the top clubs. But a lot of people will have looked at
him. He's enhanced his bargaining position, let's just say that.
A lot of people have looked at him thinking, that lad, he's a player.
Yep.
You know, and he's got to look after himself now. He's got to look after his career. And if there's a scintilla of doubt in his mind that he's not going to be a first choice for next season, then I think it's incumbent on him to do what's best for his own career.
Absolutely. Right, Dundee, it was big celebrations up the Tawdry, and rightly so. I'm with you as well, Jim. I'm not one of these that... listen, I think it has to, ultimately, when you look back in 10 years' time, or even a couple of years, nobody looks back and says, oh, we've got top six.
Yeah.
That's not something. It's cup finals, it's winning cups, it's getting into Europe are the things that, you know, a generation later you look back and you say we did that. But in that moment, absolutely celebrate it, because it's the first, after staying up, it's the first big goal. And, you know, look at what it's done on the flip side for the Hibs manager, and not getting top six, you know, it's a disaster. So, you know, it's... Mm-hmm. Absolutely an achievement worth celebrating, and good on them for doing exactly that. It kind of ends, it makes life easier for me, because I was, whether it was, you know my opinions on it, I was getting troubled with, I wasn't quite sure, say Dundee had finished seventh or even worse, eighth, whether I would have been able to say that's a good season for Dundee, because I think if they'd been seventh, that would have been the real problem position for me as to whether I would have deemed it a success. I probably would have just eighth, and I probably said, well, no, Dundee had a chance to be much better than that. Now they're sixth. Whatever happens from here on, they can absolutely say that it was a very good season.
I mean, Eric, you know what? In journalism and fandom generally, we're not quick to, I mean, you don't, particularly the local teams, you don't want to give stick. You try when you offer criticism to make it constructive, and a lot of it's opinion, a lot of it's subjective, you know. I mean, we talk sometimes glibly about professional football players who kind of, you know, have got the same problems as the rest of us. They might make a few bob more than the rest of it, but they've got the same problems as the rest of us. They've got mortgages to pay, they've got family commitments, they've got health issues, they've got a million and one things for them, you know, a whole load of things. We sometimes talk too glibly about it, you know. Very, very few that I've ever come across that give less than everything they've got when they train and when they play, you know. And most of them are good guys, you know. Most of the boys in the game are good lads, you know, the rest of it. But we kind of set high critical thresholds for them and all the rest of it. And when we do, I think it's only right that, that you actually give praise in equal measure. And Dundee have had a terrific season. Mm-hmm. They've had a great, and we've talked, you know, we watched an article about Tony Dock, and he's, you know, I mean, you like people, you got on well with people in the game, you've known them a long time, and that colours your view sometimes. But you know, taking all that aside, he has done a remarkable job, You know, and he sticks with his players. You know, even when they when they've made, you know, faux pas and given daft goals away and all the rest of it. He'll criticise, but it's minor, and immediately he comes back and he says, but I'm so proud of my boys and all the rest of it. That's very important. There's nothing that any worker likes more than knowing that the gaffer's got their back. You know, whether it's in journalism, whether it's, you know, whatever, copperdom, whether it's a joiner, you want to know your gaffer has your back. And Tony Docherty has his boys' back. And I think that's really, really important, you know. And he's put a side that have they've been robust. I mean, you know, they've been naive at times at the back. You know, they've got caught because they're quite a, you know, there are a few youngsters in and about there. But they've been robust. They've been mentally strong. They've entertained. They've actually been good to watch. I mean, I've seen some Dundee sides over the years that make your eyes bleed. I've seen United sides in recent years at me. You see sides everywhere. But Dundee have been good to watch this season. They've been entertaining. They've played some really nice stuff at times, you know. And it is an entertainment business. They're building their crowds up again. Their home core is about 5,500. So, you know, they're kind of building that up slowly. And they've got St Mirren in their sights for a fifth place finish.
They do. And they're the team now that has their. It's not a free hit. But they're playing with, they're more relaxed than St Mirren. St Mirren and Kilmarnock have been there. Mm-hmm. I know that I think Dundee have been one position higher at one point, you know, so it's not as if they've not been in that battle, but it has always felt like the positions, Celtic and Rangers, one and two, whichever way that's going to be, Hearts third set in stone, Kilmarnock field set in stone for a while, and then St Mirren have felt almost as if they're the ones that are going to be fifth. So, you know, that's a genuine a genuine battle now, and it's going to be getting into Europe. But whether they'll be a player on their own pitch in Europe, that's another thing. But we're not going to that today.
Kelly and St Mirren are more than works in progress. They've been, you know, they've been getting built over a couple of seasons now since Derek, you know, left Pittodrie to go to Kilmarnock. And he struggles early on too. A lot of people didn't fancy him.
They weren't great last season. No, they only just stayed up.
I mean, they've, you know, they have improved dramatically this season. Robson's done a great job at St Mirren. You know, he's done a tremendous job there as well. Whether he can continue, and there's another guy that people must be looking at. You know, about, you know, he must be on the radar of clubs south
should
of the border.
Should be on the radar of Hibs if they change in the summer.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, probably should be on the radar of Aberdeen as well.
Here we go.
Aberdeen are in that whole kind of, you know, I mean,
they're going to get the Swedish guy.
At least they're going for that. You know, but you know, from a Dens perspective, it's really difficult to do anything other than lavish praise on them for what they've done. There'll come a time undoubtedly when they'll get criticism and all the rest of it, but right through the side, you know, they've got a deep squad as well. They've got a good squad, and they've outgunned sides like Hibs and Aberdeen, who've got much, much bigger budgets, you know, far bigger budgets than them. So, I mean, you know, and throughout the side, I mean, McCracken and goal, I mean, I'd kind of half written my column the other week, and I was doing a piece on goalies, because goalies always fascinate me. I think it's the hardest position on the park in many respects, mentally and sometimes physically as well, you know. And I'd start to write, I dumped it for something else, but I'd actually said at one point, well, Carson will be back, you know. And he's no back. Now, I think he's fit again, you know. So you kind of think to yourself, what is it there, you know? Has he slipped away? Mm-hmm. Or has Doc looked at McCracken? I mean, this kid's good. This kid's good, you know. So they've had decent goalkeepers. For a wee while they didn't, but they've had decent goalkeepers. I like young Donnelly, you know.
He had a shocker. You have to like him because you speak to his dad every other week.
Speak to his old man every week, that's right. But no, I mean, I like him. He's kind of a young guy coming through. But generally speaking, you know, Tiffany, I like, you know, I kind of drifted for a wee while, but and I thought Dundee slipped when they took him off the other week when they lost to Motherwell. I thought they kind of went backwards a wee bit after they took him off. So I like him on because he entertains.
What he's done well, Jim, is he's managed that. I've mentioned this before, and he's managed that squad. He's kept them happy, and it's a big squad in terms. It's a big squad in terms of senior pros and ones expecting. And with the amount of loan boys he's got, if you come up on loan, you expect to play.
Yeah.
So, from what I can see, because you're not hearing anything and results aren't showing it, he's done a good job of keeping boys interested and yeah. not letting them cut adrift, because, you know, every now and again I'll see a Dundee starting lineup and think, oh, he's come back and, you know, like Finn Robertson or something. You think, all right,
you know, in this game, you,
Tiffany,
you know,
he was away, he was out of the picture for a while. Right. I think, all right, he's starting. So he's done that very well. And that is a McInnesism.
That's right. And you hear, you know,
McInnes is magnificent,
you know,
at it.
In this game, you hear the whispers all the time. When a camp is unhappy, you hear the whispers. You don't hear that about the Dundee camp. It's a happy camp. It's a settled camp. It's a good squad. It's a tight squad. They get on well together, you know. And I think by and large, you know, that I think always comes down to the manager. Mm-hmm. You know, that comes down to the manager
to
and his assistant. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not just the boss. I mean, his assistant as well. So I think, you know, they've created that kind of sense of harmony and that real kind of bond and that team spirit and all the rest.
Because it's not easy.
That's an unusual thing.
It's not easy having those. Let's face it, he'll have had loads of them over the course of the season. Conversations with guys. I'm not saying it's the old-fashioned chap on the door, gaffer, but he'll have, whether it's coming up to him on the training ground, he'll have had a lot of those conversations saying, like, you'll get your chance next week, or I still, you know, you're absolutely in front and centre with me, but these last couple of games haven't suited you. You'll be in. Yeah. You might not be playing this Saturday, but, you know, the weekend after, I think you'll be ideal for playing against Motherwell or something like that. You know, and I can imagine him being very good at them.
Yeah, and I don't think he's the sort of guy, because, so, you know, some managers will tell players, don't worry, you'll be in again.
Well, you can't lie to them.
And then they're no.
Yeah,
and
you
then
can't
no,
lie to them.
And that's fatal. I think this is where the psychology of the Docherty appointment, I think, is fascinating. I mean, you know, I mean, I think probably kind of older hands in this game, and journalism like yourself and myself kind of realise that, you know, the kind of notion of Docherty, a new manager, and you think, well, hang on a second, this guy's got huge experiences as a supposed number two to Derek McInnes. He's been with the game a long, long time. And I think the kind of role the assistant plays is often
the good cop,
bad cop, yeah, but he's psychologically the kind of go-between between the manager and the players. He's keeping the manager informed, he's keeping the players informed, he's psychologically dealing with the ups and downs of a dressing room that can be, you know, fractured or disgruntled or whatever. And I think that, you know, the kind of the people skills, the management skills that you learn over that period of time, I think are phenomenal. And I think Docherty is just, I mean, he's just excelled at that. He's absolutely excelled at that in terms of kind of how he manages men. And I honestly, I think that is as important, if no more important, than how you set a team
tactically.
Because
he's done so well and so quickly, you become more inclined to look and pick up little faults and say, well, where isn't he? And it is splitting hairs. For me, I mean, you obviously compare him to McInnes because that's the obvious one. For me, McInnes is a bit better in terms of the public facing side of it. You know what I mean? Yeah. I think McInnes is the best in the league at speaking to us and getting his message across before a game, after a game. I can never remember a press conference with Derek McInnes where I thought, we got that wrong, or he misjudged that, or he shouldn't have said that. He's an absolute master at it. And I'm including, is he better than Tommy Wright? I don't. Anyway, that's maybe. Yeah, but you know what I mean. Yeah. He's absolutely. I can't think of anybody who's better at it. And you know, I threw a question at him on Saturday past about his squad depth. And you know, you think some managers would maybe struggle with it because you know they don't want to be seen to be the ones that you know, or they almost don't want to be seen to be thinking, oh, I've got a much bigger squad than others, I'm at some sort of advantage. But you know, he spoke about that very well. He's an absolute master at it. I don't think Tony's quite as good as Derek McInnes in that regard. I'm going back to, you know, the
very few are, because McInnes is long. He's been the manager now for how many years? You
but
know,
again,
I mean, I know, I may have dealt with him everywhere. You
that's
know?
Splitting hairs.
But
he's by no means by no means poor at it, because Dundee fans love it, and ultimately that's what matters.
I mean, honestly, I was having a laugh on. I mean, I've mentioned this before on here, and I know he listens. But my big neighbour Bob, you know, Bob said the big Dundee flag flying over on the wall, and fair play him, because Dundee fans have had a hard time over a long period of time. So my wife said to me, she said, I was out in the garden there. She said, Bob's singing like a linty. He's over the moon. You know,
they lap it up, don't they?
Why would you not? I mean, you know, it's been a great season for them.
You know what, as well? It's another wee thing, and other people who are out with the city, maybe like myself, and people that look in, they look in, and it makes me chuckle when I see it. And I see Tony Dock arriving, and he arrives in the Dundee suit and tie, doesn't he?
Aye.
And then changes into his He's more sort of trendy gear for the touchline.
He's got a three-button top, and I always like that because I'm a three-button top man.
Isn't it? And he ticks all the boxes. And I saw that from his first press conference, yeah. And some people think it's a bit cringe, but he went full Dundee, didn't he, from the start? Yeah. And I think he actually said it, didn't he? He says he made a big point of saying, did he use the words, I feel the pulse of the city? He played up to that, doesn't he? And him, Docherty and Dundee fans,
he's a dead part of Klopp, I think, you know. I mean, they get each other, don't they? He's got school here, and he's been in the city a long, long time, and he understands what makes it tick. I mean, Dundee is a unique city, you know. I mean, I think very, very few people actually really kind of genuinely understand. I mean, the amount of, you know, I mean, I worked for the BBC for 30 years, and the amount of people, even within the BBC, say to me, why would Dundee United no merge? I'm saying, you don't get it. you genuinely don't get it. And people outside the city will say that. And I know people inside of saying, it would make sense. Very, very few people get into the root of what makes the two clubs tick is very, very. I was once a contact of mine or a colleague of mine at Radio 5 wanted to come up, and he was doing things on derbies, mm-hmm. and he picked up, I think it was four or five derbies he was doing. He didn't want to do Hibs and Hearts, and he didn't want to do Celtic Rangers, and he was wanting to do the Dundee derby. That was the one Scottish one he wanted to do. So I invited him up to Frew's Bar, and it was a game, and he sat with United boys and Dundee boys and all the rest of it. And he came away, and he says, I still kind of figure out what makes people United men or Dundee men, or women, mm-hmm. you know. I said, well, I don't know either. I said, I know families were a split. A dad's a Dundee fan, son's a United fan, and vice versa. And all the rest. It's very, very hard to get into the kind of the mentality of the city and the football in the city. It's almost kind of in the bones and the blood, but Docherty gets it. You know,
I think
much of it will be PR, but he gets it. He gets the same.
I just, even in terms of, there's been plenty of Dundee. I mean, Dundee have liked an ex-player, haven't they? Let's face it, as a manager over the years. So have United. Mm-hmm. You know, the two, they do like going down that route, probably too much in a lot of regards. Mm-hmm. But even in terms of, I mean, Tony Docherty had no history with Dundee. You know, this is not a man that...
No, it was all over the road.
And that never gets talked about. But I mean, he's been a journeyman's not right, but he's been a travelling assistant, you know, and a travelling football man, if you want to call it that. So, but living, he clearly lives Broughty Ferry, isn't it? You know.
Yeah.
But for a guy that's never played for the team, I can't think of somebody. Yeah, you going back to even? I mean, you know, James McPake got Dundee clearly, but he was steeped in playing for Tony Docherty to become it was almost like from day one he was like, if you were to tick all the boxes, he really was photo fit Dundee managers, you know, in terms of tick 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 tick. Tony Docherty has done that.
He talks the club up all the time.
He does, and
he doesn't. I mean, I think I used the phrase the other week. I was talking about kind of his management skills, and I was talking about the pitch as well. But you can't not mention the pitch in any article you're doing. No matter how positive you're trying to be about the club and the side, the pitch has been a nightmare. But I said it was above his pay grade, and he's right. And he doesn't stray into areas that are no his. Tony Docherty can't do anything about the pitch. You know, Tony Docherty can't do anything about, you know, if there's repairs needing done in the stand. Tony Docherty's job is to put a side in the park and to develop a Dundee football side that is more successful than not, that plays good football, that competes well and all the rest of that. And, you know, he's got pass marks and everything. He's done it. And he talks the team up and he talks the club up and he talks the city up, I think, which is a really good thing as well, you know. And that's important. And you know, one of my biggest... And that is a criticism of United. I mean, in the great days with McLean, and for a wee while United were theoretically going to try and reintroduce this.
I think there's an issue with United.
United are kind of managed and run by people who live outside the city. The American, I know Dundee have got an American owner, but one of their American owners lives in Dundee, John Nelms. John's very much committed to the city. His wife works here and all the rest of it. His family, I think his young lad's about to join the army, you know. There's a Dundee train down at Gardine, you know, the college that I used to teach at, you know, 2 miles down the road. Their manager lives in the city, a lot of the players live in the city. United are remote. You know, and there's a couple of carloads that'll come through every day. You know,
who was the manager that tried to change it? Who was the manager that tried to change it?
Um, who did try to change it? It was one, somebody, was it? Somebody talked about kind of trying to...
Not in the dim and distant past either.
Not a 5 mile radius had, you know. But now, I know that in the modern game, that's very difficult. And I know that even in England, you know, there are guys that'll drive 150 mm-hmm. mile, you know, to from Birmingham to Liverpool or something like that. That's no ideal for the hamstrings, you know. But I just kind of sense that Dundee to me at the moment seem to have a really strong local connection with the city, a really strong local connection, you know, and Docherty I think is a fulcrum to all of that, you know. I mean, kind of we should be getting a kind of a percentages wages.
We should actually, I feel
you have to give credit where it's due, and he's done a great job.
Yeah, well,
he's
done a terrific job. I don't want to. I it's one of the reasons I don't vote in our Football Writers Manager of the Year award and that, because I hate awards. I hate being asked to choose at this time of the season. It's ridiculous. You're actually coming into the most important part of the season. You know, as you can see in the English Premier League, you can see in the English Championship, because, you know, everything gets settled.
Yeah.
And why should I choose a Manager of the Year at this point? I'm not even going to do it. But
do you go to the Football Writers dinners?
I haven't been for a good few years. No, just I purely because
I stopped going after someone well known to you and I as a journalist. Almost had a scrappy Fernando Rixon. You know,
I was there that year as well.
I'm not going back, you know.
But no, that's for another podcast. But
I'm not sure who my money was on.
Yes,
day, you know?
I think suffice to say, Tony Docherty is going to be in the running in the Talking Football Podcast Manager of the Award, but we'll not spoil that. And there's been enough of a Dundee love it, and we'll not spoil it by talking about pitches or financial consequences of the pitch, etc. We'll leave that for another day. Right. Let Dundee enjoy the top six. Right, it was a bit of a twist as far as Saints were concerned. Spoke to Craig Levein yesterday. I don't think he was even watching Ross County with Rangers. He certainly wasn't going to let it become a sort of defining thing because he had zero control of it. So it's going to be a tight battle between the two of them, between Ross County and Saints.
Yeah.
From what now, I mean, just speaking about the game itself, Saints against Kilmarnock, they're just an incredibly, incredibly unpredictable, frustrating team. I mean, I think I could probably hear a few Saints fans screaming at this just now, saying, well, they are predictable terms of predictably.
Yeah,
they let them down. And while I don't think this was the display against Kilmarnock was by no means the worst this season, I think it's because, you know, Craig Levein wasn't going over the top and talking them up, and I don't think any of us were getting the top over the top and talking them up. But you know, there was improvement there. You know, we weren't making it up. They deserve something at least at the Dundee game. They deserve what they got at Hibs, and you can't dismiss that. But then, I do give the caveat that Kilmarnock, I think, are a very good... I think if the league was starting again and they got to a slower start than Hearts, I don't think there's much between them and Hearts.
I don't think
and fourth, you know, McInnes will be in the running for Manager of the Year, you can say. I mean, he's leaving Kevin Van Veen's on the bench, you know, and I made the point that Robbie Dees, who Saints would have loved to have gotten in the summer, Steve McLean didn't even bother entering the conversation because he knew they couldn't get close to what Kilmarnock would offer in terms of wages. And Dundee's for a few players, you know, other ones.
Kelly pay well.
And there he is. Kelly played three centre-halves and Dees is the man on the bench. Mm-hmm. So Kelly's fourth choice centre-half. You know, you looked at their bench and I saw at least six starters in a St Johnstone team. So that's where they are. But having said all that, they just lack a bit of... It's not effort, you know. They're a very hard team to sum up, because, and I think that's where it perplexes Craig Levein a lot as well. It's, you know, it's not we've all seen teams that, you know, you literally think they're not running enough. They're not. It's not that, but there isn't. Mm-hmm. Whether it's an inbuilt confidence, whether they've not got enough nasty characters, whether.
Well, they make mistakes. I think that's...
They just go into their shells a bit, and against the Derek McInnes team, that gets exposed. You know, Derek McInnes has built a team that St Johnstone fans have seen umpteen over year after year after year, and that jars with them when they see teams like that coming to McDermott Park and grabbing initiative a bit more. Yeah. And there are fundamental issues in terms of attacking, because he plays two left back. there are two left backs on the left hand side. Now, I don't think either of them are natural wing backs, so that tells you that that's not going to be a very creative side of the pitch. And on the other side of the pitch, you have Kelchins at right back, and there's really nobody in front of him. You know, it's they don't fill that space well enough. Good grief.
Who's in there? Smith, isn't it? Was it Smith?
Smith kind of goes across there, but he's a natural centre midfielder, and they don't fill that space well enough. Okay, they just they don't have a winger in the squad. No. If he made a mistake in terms of the recruitment and the positions he recruited, I think I can see why he wanted. He went for the pace up front and get a couple options there, and thinking that's how we'll get goals, and it has worked to an extent.
But they could
and Kim Pioca, they could really. They don't have a winger. They don't have a winger, and good grief, if Trey Wright could come back to play three or four games. Which fingers crossed they will do. It would be it would make a heck of a difference.
Well, I mean, they're now fighting for their life, and
but I have been for a while.
Yeah, I have been for a while. That's right. I think it's dead easy to say this. Another thing doing it is how do you cut out the kind of mistakes that led to Kelly's first goal? Like both the goals actually, but led to Kelly's first goal at the weekend. You know, it was slightly.
Kucharavi's not pressing the crosser. You know, with any.
That's right. You're not shutting him down, so the ball comes and you're just that fraction. It's all about fractions. You know, it's all about.
He just gets his body position right, holds him off.
It's it's about central defenders being quicker. More alert mentally, and therefore more alert physically. You know, to make up that kind of sometimes you're talking about millimeters. You know, to shut that down. I mean, you know, the shot squeezed off. It's no particularly powerful shot, but it doesn't have to be because it's only all you have to do is connect
from eight yards out,
and the keeper's got very little chance. So it's things like that. You know that, and against Kilmarnock. I think Levine said himself, you know, they've got boys that, you know, will take advantage of your mistakes because they're a sharp side. Now, you're not going to meet that in the bottom half of the table, but but Saints are in that bottom half of the table for a reason because, you know, they don't defend well enough.
They're not doing well against the top teams this season.
They don't boss midfields. They don't score enough. Now, they're up against sides that, on the face of it, they've got much more chance of beating, you know, than St Mirren's or Kilmarnock's or Dundee's, you know. But they're in a grim, grim position. And I have to say, I did not for one minute expect to see the result at,
in Dingwall. I was looking, but
it's changed things.
They deserved it as well, Ross County.
Absolutely. I mean, absolutely. But that has,
Rangers were absolutely shocking.
That's put Saints under remarkable pressure. We're only a point in it now, you know. And it could be as simple as the game between the two will be the decider. You know, I mean, I think Hibs and Motherwell, could you catch Motherwell 6 points in it? I don't think so. I mean, even Aberdeen be 4 points in it. I mean, this is a straight shootout now between Saints and Ross County. And now I think I talk about this all the time, but now it's about mentality. And it's about mentality. And that's not just about mentality, but wanting to win. It's about that desire and that hunger. But it's also about kind of that having that mentality to see danger and to shut it down and to work. You know, even if professional footballers are all very, very fit guys, but they get tired as well and they switch off mentally, physically. You know, when the lungs are searing and the legs are heavy and afterwards you should have shot that. You should have shot off that crosser. You should have been a yard closer to that guy that got the cross in. And Andy Considine should have been a fraction of a second, quicker to shot off. I mean, it's such slim margins that end up costing you very, very dearly, and it could end up costing them. It could cost them relegation.
The positive for them in terms of the split is. Saints fans might not have enjoyed it at the time, Dundee getting into the top six, but they've now got every team that's in the bottom six with them. They've either got Livingston and Motherwell, they've drawn all the games with the others. They've got a positive record over. They've got a better record against Aberdeen, Hibs, and who's the other one? Ross County.
And the thing is, I mean, against Leicester, Hibs, they've beaten Hibs already, you know.
Twice.
Hibs, I think, are a Hibs are a club, I think, in some turmoil. I think there are players there that might just kind of switched off. And
their fans really, you know, are there scunnered, aren't they?
They don't want the manager. They don't want their manager.
They
never want the manager. That's right. I mean, I mean, I said to somebody recently, I actually think that Hibs, as opposed to a manager, need an exorcist.
You get clubs that just don't like themselves, don't they? United were in that position. You know, you can go at all the different little dynamics. They don't like, it's just, it's like they're all, it's all a sense of duty, and you know, we go at the football because we do, you just think, I don't know.
And there is a thing about Hibs are kind of almost, you know, I've been watching on Netflix, I don't know how I missed it first time around, it an older series, but Mr. Monk, I don't know if you've ever seen it, I'm watching that, and his great phrase is a curse and a blessing. He's a gifted detective, curse and a blessing, you know, he's got all sorts of other issues as well, but Hibs kind of strikes me as a curse and a blessing with Hibs, because, you know, the blessing is they have had great teams over historically who've played wonderful football. You know, if you're of a certain vintage as I am, you can remember Rourke, Stanton, Cropley, you know, Blackley, Brownley, guys like that. Living up to that is another, and I think that's to some extent the curse, that they have had great sides.
United and Aberdeen, isn't it?
United and Aberdeen. And I think there's whole generations of Hibs fans that have never ever seen this, but the memory passed down for dad and granddad.
Oh, keep saying that. It was never like that. I heard it. You've like, shut up.
From the days of the famous five onwards, you know. And I sometimes think that's what's wrong. And that's why I say I think they need an exorcist to kind of just exercise that spirit about the club, get that kind of, and realise what they are. But
the Saints need one. This is Saints' third season.
So Saints can beat them, you know. Saints can.
But I mean, this is
Saints. But then so can Ross County, you know.
Saints need to. They can't. This is Saints' third season of being pretty poor,
mediocre.
Yeah. Aye. So we all know what needs to happen in the summer, and hopefully they'll have a new owner. The place needs freshness. There's no doubt about it. The place needs freshness.
Totally reinvigorated.
But I think there's a lot of people that realise that, and they just have. I mean, it does sound. Games like what Saturday and Sunday does for you in terms of not just Ross County, not just Ross County beating Rangers. It's the way they showed what St Johnstone should be doing.
Absolutely.
in terms of front foot. You know, not waiting for things to happen. Like you know, they get the shackle. They look like a team that. Now, whether it might, the dynamic might shift again, because they've had 2 weeks after that. I bet you Ross County would have wanted another game this midweek, or certainly the following Saturday.
Yeah.
They played with a team with the shackles off. St Johnstone haven't played like that for, I can't remember. You know, the one and only game they played like that was Alec Cleland's caretaker game in charge, because obviously, there's obvious reasons for that. The manager in charge isn't going to be the manager. There's a whole just sort of like, you know, there's a totally different vibe. St Johnstone need to find that. They need to somehow be less inhibited, I think, to bring that into the next vibe. Because it does feel like it's suffocating them a bit, the whole thing. And there's a bit of internal. I think there's a bit in the DNA of this particular squad that they kind of, on a couple of occasions, they shouldn't have mathematically, but it's almost as if they feel it's been a bit, not quite job done, but they kind of feel that they've almost got themselves safe, and then it's been like a drop off. They just can't have that now. And that's one of the things that I both fear about, and perversely gives me a little bit of a reassurance, is that they now, there's no option. You can't, when it comes to these five games, nobody can switch off and think this is anywhere close to being safe and being job done. They've now seen Ross County beat Rangers. They know where they are, and there has to be full on focus, and every game they need to be less inhibited. They need to go at it rather than think, oh, okay, you know, a draw might be all right, you know, if Ross County lose in this. That the time for that is gone.
No, I mean, Ross County have a kind of, it's no a secret weapon, but they have a weapon I think that Saints would give their eye teeth for, and that's Simon Murray.
Yeah, just, you know, boundless, I mean, enthusiasm.
Boundless enthusiasm, boundless pace, boundless energy, takes a goal, can assist.
Leads the line in a totally different way.
Leads the line with just that kind of that whole sense of drive and kind of
just a nuisance. He plays football without inhibitions.
Absolutely,
doesn't he? I think it's his throwback to where he came from, and he just. I'm not saying it's not the old play it with a smile on his face because he doesn't. He's not going about grinning ear from ear. But,
no, but he
doesn't play like it drags him. Nothing drags him down.
No. I mean, he's got boundless enthusiasm. I mean, I was chewing the fat with him, and I mean, he gets his shirt kidded off him when he's in my company with both of us having the red hair and all the rest. Although mine's going somewhat grey now, but I was speaking to him in the barbers. Just at the time we got the same barber.
He was trying to get a move.
At the time, he looked like he might be coming back to Dens or Tannadice, and he was keen. He was keen. But I mean, there's a lot of players who keen to be moved. They wouldn't be given it. But that's no Simon. He's just got that kind of that great. He's got just a great love and enthusiasm for the game, And I think in this dogfight that they're in now, that can be the difference between going into that playoff place and not. So that's a massive bonus, I think, for Ross County. And the other massive bonus.
Dan's going in the summer.
If you know that you can. Go on your own turf and cuff Rangers 3-2 because it's not easy, irrespective of how bad Rangers are. It's not because they've got better players than
others would do it if it was easy. Yeah,
I mean, that will give them enormous self belief going into these remaining five games, And I think that's a danger now. Saints are going in kind of with a psychological flatness about them, Ross County are coming in with a bound. We're kind of boundless enthusiasm for the next game here, when are the fixtures announced?
But Thursday, I think. So, I think, Jim, the first game for both of them is enormous. I think the last time around, Saints had United first up, beating them just both. It took the wind out of. Because remember, United were coming into the split, having feeling good about themselves, then the 2 week break. Kind of interrupted their rhythm. Saints beat them, and United lost them all, and Saints got the job done with three games into the playoffs. So,
I think it was last week on this we were talking about. I was saying this is where Levine's experience and all the rest of it comes in, and he's up against Don Cowie, a much less experienced manager, very experienced footballer. But for Cowie to put the team out, and I'm hearing very good things from people I know in the Highlands, about him as a manager, and he's not a showy guy. There's Levine, but he's not a showy guy. He's kind of just gets on with it, getting on with the training ground and all the rest of it. But he's set that side up, that kind of five-man midfield he put out against Rangers, just competed brilliantly, completed brilliantly, and they won deservedly. I mean, watched the goals again this morning before it came out. They won that game well. You don't kind of win with three on the break against Rangers, three lucky goals. I mean, they won that game well. They competed. They took Rangers to task. They set off with the right mentality, off on the front foot, went at it from the opening whistle. And I think they're really kind of sending a message to Saints. Here's what you need to do, because I think they'll do that. That'll be Ross County from now to the end of the season. The psychological boost they will get from that one, I think, is phenomenal. And that's worrying for Saints.
Yeah, we'll know. I think we'll know after game one, what's the direction of travel is. So we've got a couple of weeks to find out. But there you are, Jim. Look, we've gone over an hour. I knew we'd have no problem. The two of us. You never.
My throat's going.
Poor lad. No. Good man, Jim. Well, thank you very much. And thank you for listening. We'll be back next week. Maybe two will become three again. You never know. Okay. Bye-bye just now.